All right, if you will, take your Bibles and turn with me over to the book of Philippians. This is not what some would consider a Christmas scripture, but we're going to use it as a Christmas message. And we want to begin our reading with verse number 5, Philippians chapter 2, verse number 5. Notice what Paul is saying in his writing here under the anointing of the Holy Spirit. Paul says to us, let this mind be in you, which was also in Christ Jesus, who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God, but made himself of no reputation and took upon him the form of a servant and was made in the likeness of men. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. Wherefore, God also hath highly exalted him and given him a name which is above every name, that at the name of Jesus every knee should bow, of things in heaven and things in earth and things under the earth, and that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord, to the glory of God the Father. O Lord, how we praise you that you robed yourself in flesh because you loved us so much. May we see that greatest holy night in this message. In Jesus' name, amen. I want to bring to you a message that I've titled, The Greatest of All Holy Nights. The Greatest of All Holy Nights. Now, this time of year, I was telling Miss Virginia just a few moments ago, I love music this time of year. Well, I love music anytime, but I really love music this time of year, especially when we get into some of the Christmas, showing up Christmas music. Now, I'm not talking about jingle bells and that type stuff, even though I do like to hear some of that. But I'm talking about songs like Silent Night and those songs that really lift up what it's all about. But probably one of my most favorite is the Christmas hymn titled, O Holy Night. How many of you like that? Amen. Hands up all over the building. O Holy Night. Well, you know, this past Wednesday night, I wasn't here. I got Barry to fill in for me this past Wednesday night, and my brother had invited us to go to Jacksonville with them, and so I got to spend some quality time with my brother and his wife, and we were going shopping. Didn't turn into anything like that, but we did have a pretty good time, a fellowship with my brother. And coming home, that song just happened to come on the radio. And I listened to it, and it was pretty good. I don't remember who was singing it, but I did remember that I had two different versions of it on my phone. One of those versions of that song was sang by a singer that we love who lives in Stark, Florida. His name is Daniel Cruz. Daniel is the on-campus songstress at the First Baptist Church of Jacksonville, Florida. We love Daniel. We got to know him when we were at First Baptist Nashville. And one of those versions of that song was sang by Daniel Cruz. And boy, it was good. He's got some pipes. You hear me? And then the other version of that song, we listened to both versions that night. The other version of that song was sang by David Phelps. Anybody ever heard David Phelps? Well, I'm going to tell you what, he's got some pipes too. And it was really good. But now, I want to tell you something about that song. Do you know when that song was actually written that it was frowned on by the church? It really was. It was frowned on by the church authorities, and they denounced that particular song and said that it had poor taste because it didn't have any religious tones whatsoever. Well, we don't ever like anything that kind of steps on our toes. I kind of get that regularly from some of the sermons I preach from time to time. I had somebody to tell me not long ago, said, "Whoa, preacher," said, "you really stepped on my toes today." You know what I said? Wasn't aiming at your feet. I was aiming at your heart. Amen? Don't mean to step on toes, want to hit the heart. You see, the first stanza of that beautiful hymn invites us to close our eyes and to imagine the world before the birth of the Lord Jesus Christ. And it says something like this, that a world that lay in sin and error pining. But we don't like to hear that about our sin. Nobody wants to hear that they're a sinner in need of a Savior. Junior Hill made the statement in one of his sermons one day about people being sinners in need of a Savior. Had a man to come forward, and the man, Junior, said, "Do you want to confess your sin?" He said, "I don't sin." You know, we got to realize that we're a sinner before we can realize we need a Savior. Amen? So we don't like, no wonder the religious leaders didn't want to have this song included. The word pining in that song refers to a washing away of the human spirit that is grieved and endured with pain. Sin brings about pain. The great evangelist Freddie Gage, who's with the Lord now, said sin thrills for a season, but then it kills. Sin fascinates for a while, but then it assassinates. And friends, that's theological, because the Bible says the wages of sin is death. Boy, I'm glad that verse didn't stop there. It says, but the gift of God is eternal life through Christ Jesus our Lord. So in other words, what the author of this song was doing was painting a picture of a world that was in darkness. And boy, if you don't believe that we're there now, you're not watching things. Amen. The world hasn't changed very much. We still live in a world that's filled with darkness. A world, the author of the song said we live in a world filled with darkness, a world that's without light. This world grieves and it pains. In other words, he pictures this world in despair and seemingly without hope. But then he writes three little words, till he appeared. Woo, hallelujah. Till he appeared. Did you get that? Till he appeared. And then things begin to change. Well, why? Well, he appeared to change the world. And friend, he's going to change the world. Now, he's in the process of changing the world one soul at a time right now. But one day soon, and I tell you what, the way it's looking right now, it's going to be sooner than later. One day soon, he's going to split the eastern skies. Amen. And he's going to take his proper place of authority. You see, this time of year, we celebrate the first Advent. But I'm here to tell you that there's going to be a second Advent, and it's going to take place real soon. And in that second Advent, he's not going to be born as a baby, and he's not going to be lying in a manger wrapped in swaddling clothing. But friends, he's going to enter in on a great white horse.
Amen.
And he's going to bring his army with him. And the thing about bringing his army with him, they won't even have to lift a finger, because the battle is the Lord's.
Amen.
His army's just going to have to see him take care of business. At no time of the year are we more reminded of just how much he's changed the world than at Christmas time. Now, I love Christmas lights. I'm looking forward to our trip to Suwannee. I went to Suwannee, I don't think we went last year, but we went the year before last, and we thoroughly enjoyed it. We went over to St. Augustine to see the lights. You know, they say that St. Augustine is the 10th wonder of the world as far as lights are concerned. I wasn't very impressed. I really wasn't. But it was, I mean, I'm not going to tell you that it wasn't beautiful, because it was. But I wasn't impressed. I mean, all you could see was white light. And I don't have no problem with white. Boy, the Christmas trees are beautiful. I enjoy white lights. But I kind of like red'uns and green'uns too. You know what I mean? A little bit, add a little bit of color to it. And so we enjoyed that. We enjoyed St. Augustine. But I'm looking forward to going to Suwannee to see the lights. Now, at no time of year is the light more evident. All these lights we see in the window on the wreath, they're beautiful. Beautiful. Reminds us that Jesus is the light of the world. Now, Paul, unlike the gospel writers, he never tells us the story of Christmas. Really and truly, he doesn't. But here in this tremendous passage of Scripture, he tells us of the glory of Christmas. And he tells us why the light on that particular night, that the light of the world, Jesus, why he was born on that particular holy night. He gives us a beautiful picture of that, and I want to share that with you real quickly. The first thing that I want you to see in this scripture is that Christmas is the celebration of a son. It is the celebration of a son. Now listen to me. Did you know that there is no, listen, I want you to get this. Did you know that there is no recorded birth in scripture after the birth of the Lord? Did you know that? Nobody else's birth is ever recorded in Scripture after the Lord Jesus is born. Did you know that the last genealogy of a family tree listed in the New Testament is that of the Lord Jesus Christ? Because the entire Bible, listen to me, from the book of Genesis to the book of Malachi, it pointed to the birth and the name of Jesus Christ. Do you know that you can find Jesus in Genesis? And you can find him all the way through to the book of Malachi? You see, the Bible has a theme. You know what the theme of the Bible is? Jesus. Jesus is the theme of the entire Bible. Paul, he doesn't give us any details about his birth. But what Paul does do is give us a theological look at why the Lord Jesus Christ is born. Now, Matthew and Luke, we see the historical event. But Paul gives to us the theological truth. Now, beginning in verse 6, look at what it says. Who being in the form of God, thought it not robbery to be equal with God. Now the word for equal here means to be equal in size, equal in quality, equal in character, and equal in number. In every way, listen to me, in every way, Jesus Christ was and is God. He was and is God. Even though he did not cling to his equality with God, he claimed it, and those who heard him knew that he claimed it. Well, preacher, can you show me that? Yes. In John's Gospel, chapter 5, verse 18, listen to what the Bible says. Therefore, the Jews sought all the more to kill him. To kill who? To kill Jesus, because he not only broke their Sabbath, not only broke the Sabbath, but also said that God was his Father, making himself, the Bible says here, equal with God. Now, Paul goes on to say in verse 6, being in the form of God. Again, the word form is a word that refers to a Roman stamp. In the biblical times, the official government document was sealed with a wax seal. The wax was hot, and they would press their ring, or the emperor would press his ring insignia into the document, and that impression of wax would be the exact representation of the insignia that was on the ring. What Paul is telling us here is that Jesus is the exact representation of God. If you want to see God, look at Jesus.
Amen.
Look at Jesus. This is exactly what Jesus himself said again when he was here on earth. In John's Gospel chapter 14, verse number 9, Jesus says, he who has seen me has seen the Father. Paul is telling us here, listen, that even though the Lord Jesus Christ laid aside his glory and took on the form of a servant and came as a man, he never ceased to be God. Now, Jesus became a man, and there was no subtraction. I want to say that again. Jesus became a man, and there was no subtraction. Now, preacher, what are you talking about? He still remained God in all of his fullness. Now, there was a time when Jesus was God, but not a man. John 1, 14, and the Word was made flesh. Well, let's back up. John 1, 1. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was God, and the Word was with God. In verse 14 says, and the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. God robed himself in flesh. So now listen to me. There was a time when Jesus was God, but not man. But there never has been a time that Jesus was man and not God. There's no division there. Jesus did not give up his godhood to make room for his manhood. He was not part human and part divine. He was not a mixture of God and man. I preached many times he was man, but yet he was God. But now listen to me. His deity was not humanized, and his humanity was not defiled. Instead, he was fully God throughout his earthly life. That's why he did not sin like we sin. He would not have been the perfect Savior if he had sinned. What happened when Jesus became a man was not subtraction or division, but it was addition. You see, he took upon himself human nature. He robed himself in flesh, a feeling that he had never before possessed, and he added humanity to his deity, and he remained both God and man, two natures in one personality. Now, I want you to understand this. If Jesus Christ was not God, then Christmas may as well just be a fairy tale.
Right.
Once upon a time. But Jesus is God. Why did Jesus leave the glory of heaven to face the grief of earth? You ever thought about that? He didn't have to, but he did. Why did he do that? Why would he cloak himself with humanity along with his deity, when in heaven everything was glorious. In heaven, everything was an honor. Everything in heaven was praise. Everything in heaven was adoration. But he robed himself in flesh. Why would he come to a planet where he was going to be ridiculed, rejected, despised, crucified, killed, dead? And as my old buddy Jerry Clyde would say, graveyard dead. Amen. Graveyard dead. Why would he do that? I heard somebody say, because he loved us.
Amen.
I don't mind you helping to preach. It's all right. He was the only one who could do it. He was the only one who could come. The angels couldn't come and take away our sin. He was the only one. Look at verse number 8. And being found in the fashion as a man, he humbled himself. Boy, we could use some of that around here. We could use some of that in the Congress of the United States of America.
Amen.
The Bible says he humbled himself. I don't know that we can ever fully understand the sacrifice that Jesus made to come and live among us and die for us. Listen, Jesus, I like this. In fact, whenever I type this, I kind of had me a little one. I'm glad you was asleep, honey. That's all I can say. Because I jumped up from my desk and I said, well, hallelujah! Woo, hallelujah! Jesus left the penthouse of heaven and came down to the outhouse of earth that he might be, whoo, hallelujah, I say yeah, hallelujah.
Amen.
Boy, that's good right there. I don't care what nobody says. Boy, I'm glad he come to be our Savior. That's so good, I got to say it one more time. He left the penthouse of heaven and came to the outhouse of earth to be our Savior. Glory to God, I'm glad that he did.
Amen.
Secondly, Christmas is the humiliation of the Savior. Look at verse 8 again. And being found in fashion as a man, he humbled himself and became obedient unto death, even the death of the cross. I must needs go home by the way of the cross. There's no other way but this. Oh, friend, if you're trying to get there any other way, there's no other way. The cross upon which Christ died bought our salvation and pardoned us from sin and shame. He left heaven and came to earth to live among us as a man, not only to live among us, but he came to die among us. God knows what it is to die. My good preacher buddy, Joy Taylor, lost his mama yesterday to death. Last year about this time, we lost our precious mama Prita to death. And oh, I'm going to tell you something, death hurts. It hurts, and it grieves. And I love all these people that think they know how to handle grief. Well, bless God, you just need to get over it. Honey, you don't ever get over it. You just get past it. And it can rear and raise its head up at any moment. Any moment. Thanksgiving, there wasn't but four of us in our house where there's usually a big family, but there was four of us there. And I looked down at the far end of my table where my mama used to sit when she'd come to our house. Guess what reared its head up in the heart? Grief for just a moment. But you see, I've got past the hurt of her death because I know where she is. And while I can't bring her back here, oh, hallelujah, I can go to where she is.
Amen.
And we don't serve a God that doesn't know what we go through when we die. I had a fellow to look at me one time and say, where was God when my boy died? And I didn't know what in the world I was going to say to him because I had never heard that before. I'd watched his boy die with him, terminal cancer, and it was a bad situation. And you know, you try to be there to provide comfort in a time of need. And in anger, he looked at me and he said, where was God when my boy died? And this is what I said to him. He was at the same place, standing right there. The same place that he was standing is where he was at when his only begotten son drawed his last breath on the cross of Calvary. I said, Jesus knows your pain. And he knows what you're going through. He knows what it is to die. Because he died, but he didn't have to. But he died for us. So he humbled himself unto death, even the death of the cross, so that we could have life and have it more abundantly. Why did he do it? John 3:16. I'll tell you why he did it. For God so loved the world that he gave his only begotten Son, that whosoever believeth in him should not perish. Listen, but have everlasting life. Boy, I like that right there. Amen. You hear me? And Jesus said in John 11:26. I know y'all hear this verse a lot, but I love it because it never changes. And he that liveth and believeth in me shall never die. Now I know some of you are looking to die. And I know that ain't good grammar and ain't good to say every now and then. My wife used to tell me, I said ain't too much in my sermons. But I'm going to go ahead and tell you right now, I ain't gonna die. Did you catch that? Yeah. Honey, I'm sorry. I know I butchered that, but I ain't gonna die. I like what the coach from Irwin County said yesterday whenever they took him up on the platform. They had to just about tote him up there on the platform, sit him down in a chair. That's how weak he is. Presented him that state championship trophy. And when they finally put that microphone in front of his face, with tears running down his eyes, he said, oh, what a platform to get to witness for my Savior. And this is what he said. He said, if you ain't got God, you ain't got nothing. Woo, hallelujah. And he told the truth.
Yes, he did.
Me and Marta sitting there trying to hold our composure, and I looked over at hers and tears, looked over at her and tears running down her eyes. And I'm trying to talk, and I'm saying, did you hear what he said? Boy, I had that old ugly crying face. Did you hear me? I mean it. Tears running down. I said, you hear what? I said, he give God praise. You hear that? Isn't that good? For God so loved the world. That's why he died on the cross of Calvary. He didn't do it out of obligation. He did it out of obedience to what his Father wanted. Paul speaks of his dying, even the death of the cross. He didn't die an ordinary death like we may get to die. I mean, we could start preaching on the cross right now and tell you how ugly that was. And the sad thing about that is they beat him just about to death. Then made him carry his cross. And then hung him on it and watched him die. That's humiliating right there. He endured. The writer of Hebrews said he endured in Hebrews 2:2. He endured the cross, despising the shame. Jesus died an initial death as the Lamb of God slain from the foundation of the world. He died for you. He died for you. How can people walk away and reject such love? I haven't figured it out yet. If you figured out, would you please help me? How can people neglect so great a salvation? The last thing that I want you to see in this is Christmas is the exaltation of the sovereign Savior. I like what it says. Wherefore God has highly exalted him. Did you catch that? God has highly exalted him. Now, I don't know about you, but a lot of times when I read this Bible, I close my eyes sometimes when I read something, and in my mind's eye, I let it take me to the place that it happened. I can see Jesus on the side of a hill. All his disciples are there with him among all the others that are present. And I can see as God begins to highly exalt him, as he begins to ascend into the heavens. Jesus said, it is expedient that I go. If I go not away, the Holy Spirit will not come. But you see, when Jesus left, he didn't leave us comfortless. He said, I'll not leave you comfortless. I will come to you. And he comes to us by his Spirit. So we celebrate his exaltation. Yes, he was born as a baby. Yes, he grew up in a carpenter's shop. By the way, I had the funeral of a carpenter the other day. And I was at the graveside, and the Lord reminded me that Jesus was a carpenter. And I just couldn't help but use that as an illustration in the life of this man, because he'd worked hard building houses all his life. I said, you know, the Lord's building many mansions. Maybe he just needed a little help. Not that he did, but he called him another carpenter home. You talking about bringing comfort to a family? That really did. That really brought comfort to that family. But you see, Jesus is going to build whether we get there or not. A dead Savior, listen to me, a dead Savior is not worth commemoration. But a risen Lord called for exaltation. Did you get that?
Amen.
Wherefore God has highly exalted him and given him a name that is above every name. Now, I don't know how many people that were born along the time that Jesus Christ lived on this earth might have been named Jesus. I mean, I know some Jesuses now. There's a lot of Jesuses in this old world now. For those of you who don't know, that's Spanish for Jesus. I don't know how many people may have been walking the earth during the time of the Lord Jesus when he was walking this earth who may have been named Jesus. The Bible don't tell us that there was ever another individual named Jesus. But you know what makes Jesus' name so highly exalted? Look at verse 11. And that every tongue should confess that Jesus Christ is Lord. Amen. Did you catch that? Jesus Christ is Lord. That's what makes it highly, or what makes him highly exalted. But you see, the thing is, and the question that I want to ask you today, have you crowned him Lord of your life? You see, a lot of times we accept Christ on our terms. But you need to understand it don't work that way. He's either Lord of all or he's not Lord at all. Amen. To be exalted, Jesus Christ must be Lord. Now listen to me as we close. Christmas reminds us that we are to accept his lordship. And that at the same time as we accept his lordship, it's that time that we bow to self to accept his glory. We disrobe ourselves of self so that we can put on Christ. The only way that you'll ever be fit for use in God's kingdom is to disrobe yourself of self and be filled with the Spirit of God, and he'll use you for his glory. To bow the knee is a sign of surrender. It's an act of humility. We sing that old song, Steve, I surrender all. But you know, we could change the words of that. Many of us could. What are you talking about, preacher? We could change the words. We could change the words to I surrender some. God don't want us to surrender some. He wants us to surrender all. And today, my friend, I challenge you that if you haven't made him Lord of your life, if you haven't emptied yourself completely of yourself, I invite you to do that at an altar of prayer in just a few moments. We'll have a hymn of invitation. And if God's speaking to your heart and you find yourself wrapped up in self, there's a good place to disrobe self and do business at an altar of prayer. Humble yourself, kneel before the King of Kings, Lord of Lords, empty yourself of self, and let God work in your life. You may be here this morning and you've never, ever accepted this Savior that I've tried to tell you about today, that is Lord of Lords and Kings of Kings. Friends, I want you to know he loves you, and his message has never changed. His message is one simple four-letter word, come. Come. That's all he asks for us to do. Come. Come. Friend, if you're not saved by the grace of God, Jesus is standing today saying, come. Come to me. Come. Now, I don't know what you may have need of in your life today. If there's anything you need, I want you to come. Maybe you need to make this church home. Maybe you need to step out by faith and God may be telling you you need to do something for his glory. Whatever you need to do, the message has never changed. It's still come. So stand with me and let's pray. Father, I've given to your people that you've given me. It's yours. Use it for your glory. In Jesus' name, amen.